I'm Zdenek from Codasip, and what I'd like to show you here is how we can efficiently use RISC-V for heterogeneous compute, how we can enable innovations that we heard so many times yesterday and today again in the keynotes, and how we position, in this case, the tooling that that you can use. So firstly, in 5 minutes, say, let me do a couple of introductions. So first of all, let me go through the company introduction, and then also I will kind of, you know, lay down the foundation for the demo itself. So, you know, what we will see and the methodologies and this sort of thing, so then you can understand the demo better. Then you will have the hands-on experience in the end. And finally, you know, last couple of closing mark points. So really briefly, Codasip was founded back in 2014, HQ in Munich. We have research centers or R&D centers across the Europe. So we have a UK, France, you know, Czech Republic, of course, Germany, and so on. So if you are looking for a job, don't hesitate to stop by the booth. We're happy to, you know, review your CV. We are RISC-V IP company. So what we do is that we provide RISC-V IPs plus the tools by which you can enable innovation or differentiation that you might need. And we will dive into the details in a second. By the way, we are a founding member of RISC-V, RISC-V as such, a couple of other activities as well. Let me dive a bit more deeper in a case of how we operate or what we offer. So let's start with the right-hand side. So as I mentioned, so Codasip is a provider of RISC-V IPs. We have a wide selection, starting from the embedded up to the, you know, application class CPU running in the multi-core cluster. They are fully verified, meaning they are not templates, they are not examples. It's part of the story that we believe in verifications. So we do a lot of them. And if you need just RISC-V IP, this is all you need. You can take it, you can implement it. We have a huge success in this case, and that's it. But if you are looking for differentiation, maybe if you are looking for innovations that we, by the way, heard nicely in the keynote from Luca Benini today, then, you know, we need to do something a bit more different. And that's the left-hand side of the screen at the moment. So the thing is that all of the RISC-V IPs that we have are written in the high-level description language that we call Codal. And this is an input to the tool that we call Codasip Studio. So the tool can just, you know, parse and, you know, read the input file that describes architecture as well as the microarchitecture of the processor. And it generates all you need. It generates a compiler, a set of new instructions, and generates RTL, test benches, simulators, and pretty much everything you need to implement the CPU and also to program the CPU. So let me just show the methodology slide, because we will cover that partially in the demo itself. So at the left side, we can see the input, which is a Codal model. Then we give it to the studio, and then you can see that we have the SDK over here and the HDK over here. So this is a software development kit and the hardware development kit. What you can do is you can give it a program, and you can profile that, you can find out where you stand, and maybe you are interested to, you know, add more instructions, or maybe remove instructions, or maybe you are interested in to improve microarchitecture and these sort of things. So today, we will focus mainly on the SDK portion, so we won't dive into the HDK because we don't have time for that. But if we are into that, just stop by the booth and we can show you more. But for this demo, let's focus on the SDK. So what we will see is we will start with the Codal model, we'll run through the studio, and we will get the SDK, and we will evaluate different types of the SDK depending on findings during the profiling. So as I mentioned, the important part is the input, so we will cover that in a second. So what I'd like to mention here as well is this this orange rows, which we call SDK in the loop and the HDK in the loop. And the important thing is that it is in the loop. So while you are doing these explorations, you can, you know, find out what's good, what's bad, and you can play with that. And we know what we are talking about because we are using these tools actively to improve RISC-V. So, you know, in the members day, we had a nice talk by Tarek, who was, you know, showing the improvements in the code size. And part of the story was a studio. This is the HDK part, again, in the loop, so you can do the synthesis, you can do many iterations per day as well. But back to the input. So in this example, what we're going to show you is we will take one of our IPs, which is the embedded processor. It's highly configurable. You can see the block diagram over here. You can configure a memory subsystem, you can configure ISA, you can configure whether you have, you don't have FPU and so on. Everything is verified. Every single configuration you can choose from is verified. So you can, you know, play with that and you can deploy that immediately. But what I'd like to show you today is this this guy over here, the custom extensions, which is important part of our story. And this is the, exactly the thing that enables the innovation or differentiation. So let's dive now into the real demo. So stop. So I will switch to the tooling. So what you can see is our IDE is Eclipse based. So anybody who's familiar with Eclipse recognizes that. And what we can see on the left side is that we have three projects. We have one that represents the processor, and then we have two source codes or applications, if you will, that we will try to you know, optimize or profile to find out where a sweet spot can be and how we can leverage the custom instructions. So the first step in the methodology, if you remember, is to just profile what we have to find out where we are. So let's start with the FIR filter. The FIR filter is a standard filter, is just, you know, taken from somewhere. We can compile that, which I already did. You can see it in the console over here. And what I can do right now, I can just run the profiling tools to find out where we stand. If I do that, I can see nice results. I can see the total number of clock cycles. If I go to source code coverage, I can see that, you know, there's no surprise, the majority of the time is spent in the FIR itself. But I can also go back. I can see nice annotations. If I move a mouse pointer, I can see easily that what I can do, or what I should do, is to add multiple and accumulate. So let's do that. And this is not a big effort, because all I need to do is write a couple lines of code, because we are exploring the SDK. So in this case, what I need to write is this piece of code. It's like 20 lines of code. So I'm describing adding a new instruction. I'm using register operands, which are defined already in the CPU. I'm defining how the instruction looks like in a text, how it's encoded. So this follows the RISC-V spec. And then more importantly, we have the behavior. We're just reading source operands. We are doing the multiple and accumulate and writing results back. So now I have it. I can create a new SDK, which I already did in the background. And now I can switch the SDK and I can rerun the profiling again to find out where we stand. So I can switch the SDK to this one. I can recompile and I can rerun the profiling. And suddenly we can see an improvement, because it went from 70,000 to 15,000. Okay, nice example. If we go back and if we see what happened, we can indeed see that the Mac was used, right? So what we can do next? Well, we can try to optimize the loads and stores, because we are keeping loading and storing all the time. So what we can do is, well, we can add the loads and stores with post increment or pre increment. Which again, if I go back to Codal, nothing really complicated, because all I need to do, similarly to the previous case, I'm using some operands. I'm defining how it looks like in text. I'm defining how it looks like in binary format. And then look here. So we are loading the address. This is how we define the instruction. Then we are reusing already existing load store unit, so nothing really fancy. And then we are writing the post increment and then the results back. So all I need to do is just write this piece of code. What I can do is I can rerun. Again, I can switch the SDK. So let's go to number two. I can recompile. And if I look at the binary, I can see that there are our instructions with the post and pre-increment. I can see them over here. So what I can do, I can rerun the profiling one more time, which is over here. I can see that I'm going down and down by just writing 40 lines of code. So I showed you the computation, I showed you the memory operations. So what next? Well, we can try the control operations. So let's add my favorite zero overhead loop, because it's part of the DSP environment anyhow. So let's try to look how the zero overhead loops may help. In the case of the zero overhead loops, it's nothing really fancy. What you can see here, I make it really visible, hopefully. Assembly binary is the same, no big difference. But then I'm kind of showing that, okay, we're going to have the hardware loop, and this is part of the front-end logic. I just took it to show it to you. You can write it in any way you want, but this is just an example how you know we can write it. So once again, we can switch the SDK to the version that has it, which I have over here. I can compile again, and now I can run it one more time. And look where we ended up. Suddenly we have 7,000 cycles. And I can keep continuing in this direction. I can iterating really fast because the next thing will be I can add CMD or vector operations. And I can continue previewing that. By the way, if I look back, say to the instruction coverage, which is over here, I can see that the zero where loops were indeed used. Because one thing that you may probably noticed is that I haven't touched the C code. So the compiler is smart enough to pick these instructions automatically. I haven't touched anything, which is important because then you can really keep iterating really fast. The last thing that I'd like to show you as an example is another application, which is Bitterverse. So this is synthetic benchmark, to be honest, but you can find this in FFTs or other algorithms. So this is interesting because it shows also compiler capabilities. In this example, you know, we use this implementation of the Bitterverse. So if I run it, if I can compile it, of course, with the vanilla to kind of get the baseline. So now if I profile the baseline, I can get up to 11,000 clock cycles to do this. So then what we can do next, and this is shown over here, is I can implement the Bitterverse operations as well. And again, the story is exactly the same. I need to define which operands I use. I need to define assembly and binary, and then behavior of instruction. In this case, it's quite simple. You can just read the operand. You can reuse a couple of built-ins that we already have. You don't have to, you can. And because you can put also the implementation as you see it and see. But in this case, let's use this built-in. I can recompile everything one more time. So I can switch the SDK over here to number 3. I can run it, compile it. And what I'd like to show you over here is, again, the use of our instruction. Okay, do we make it smaller? Come on. Here we go. So we can see that this instruction was used automatically. So even though the code looks a bit challenging, I will disable the annotation in this case, because it's not a single line, right? It's a bunch of lines that has to be recognized that the algorithm does the reverse. And now I have this new application. I can profile it one more time. This is the last profiling I'm going to show you today. And voila, we have the speed up, which is significant. It's not like 10%, right? It's you know, a couple of hundreds of percent of the speed up that you get through this exploration. So now, in this case, it definitely makes sense to have this implementation in your CPU. And maybe we can make it part of the, say, next version of RISC-V ISA, maybe something in some extensions that we're going to develop in the future. Which leads to the conclusions. I think that I'm still on time, I hope. So, thanks to the fact that you know, some of the semiconductor rules or laws are, you know, failing or stopping, depending on how we believe in it, we need to have a way how we can drive for the new architectures to the new way how we can get the performance. And we believe in heterogeneous compute. We believe that if you do the right thing at the right part of the SoC, this is the best thing to do. And RISC-V is the best perfect fit thanks to the ISA extensions that everybody knows. So this is something that enables innovation and differentiation. Now you might not use it because RISC-V gives you all you need, that's fine. But maybe if you are looking for something else, something better, then RISC-V is definitely a good choice. And our tooling helps with the automation. So you don't have to do it manually, even though you can do it. And in general, there is nothing wrong with that. But you know, imagine the automation. Imagine how fast you can be in the iterations to find the right spot, right solution for your task. So yeah, this is the final thing. Thank you for your time and attention. If you have any questions, we have a booth over there. Just stop by. Our guys will, you know, help you to answer these questions. feel free to go there. Thank you.